These top two equations are the Lorentz transformation equations for arbitrary direction. In this video, I will demonstrate that they are just that by deriving the velocity addition formula they yield for arbitrary direction and show that this yields a speed c, which is also independent of the direction of the velocity of the light. I will then give a simple proof that my accelerated transformation equations are what give the natural choice for the coordinates of an observer accelerated with arbitrary time dependence. You usually see the Lorentz transformation equations for arbitrary direction in terms of big matrices, but this is a way I worked out to express them in a much more compact way. In order to understand what I mean by the expressions in these equations, the way that I have defined them, I must point out first that beta, r, and r prime are not true vectors. What I mean by them and how I am defining the inner product for these expressions. The beta pseudovector means this set of three elements, beta x, beta y, and beta z. R prime means this set of three elements, x prime, y prime, and z prime. R means this set of three elements, x, y, and z. And what I mean by the inner product, for example, given beta dot r prime, is defined by beta x, x prime, plus beta y, y prime, plus beta z, z prime. I need to point out what I mean by this inner product in this fashion, because you might be used to using unit vectors, in which case the inner product depends on the direction of the two different coordinate systems' unit vectors. I'm not using unit vectors here. And in fact, if you choose to use unit vectors in your expression of these pseudovectors, then you actually have to mean by those unit vectors just an indicator of where the elements are in the set, not something that's associated with frame. If you choose to tag these pseudovectors with unit vector notation, you must keep in mind that the unit vectors you tag the components with indicate the place in the set, not a direction which may be associated with one or the other frame. So here I derive the velocity addition formula for Lorentz transformation with arbitrary direction. Since gamma and beta are constants, and given the way I've defined the inner product, differentiating the transformation yields the right-hand side top two equations. Dividing the bottom one by the top, I get dr dct. And dividing both the numerator and the denominator by dct prime and factoring out a gamma on the bottom, I get the velocity addition formula for arbitrary direction of velocity between the frames. The bottom is then the velocity addition formula expressed in terms of u, u prime, and v. And that holds for arbitrary direction between the two frames and for arbitrary direction of the velocity of the thing that is observed. Next, I will demonstrate that this resulting velocity addition formula yields an invariant speed c, even with arbitrary direction in light's direction of velocity. To do this, start by squaring this by taking the inner product with itself. Then simplify. I will use a gamma identity to replace gamma squared beta squared and gamma squared minus 1, at which point three terms in the numerator will factor. This equation directly implies that if the speed of something is c according to one frame, it is also c according to the other. The dr prime dct prime term being 1 for dr prime dt prime being equal to c, will yield a 1 minus 1 in the numerator, and then the numerator will wind up being equal to the denominator, and you get the right-hand side equaling to 1. So then that means dr dct is also equal to 1, or dr dt is also equal to c. So the speed according to 1 being c implies that the speed according to the other is also c. This is sufficient to prove by what is meant by Lorentz transformation, that the equations that I gave are indeed Lorentz transformation for arbitrary direction. Because of this result, there is no need to do matrix algebra and see that they are equivalent to the messy matrix expressions you will find elsewhere. You might want to do that as an exercise, but because Lorentz transformation means the transformation that leaves the speed c invariant, this resulting property, this resulting formula for the square of the speed related between the frames, that directly implies an invariant speed c, which proves that these are indeed Lorentz transformation for arbitrary direction. Now the problem arises, how does one describe the standards of space and time for an observer that is accelerated? The premise of general relativity is that the laws of physics do not depend on frame. So general relativity is a modeling of physics with tensor equations, because they yield the same laws for any frame. So in fact, using the geodesic equation to describe the motion of things in free fall, etc., it actually does not matter what kind of coordinates you want to use as an accelerated observer. What I mean by the natural choice for an accelerated observer's coordinates are two things, really, which I will show my transformation equations yield. Number one, I mean that the coordinates are locally Lorentzian during acceleration. And number two, I mean that during times of constant velocity, the accelerated observer's coordinates everywhere correspond to that of an inertial frame, that they will reduce to being related to an inertial frame observer's coordinates by those arbitrary Lorentz transformation equations. These requirements will guarantee that the kinds of rulers and clocks the accelerated observer uses nearby himself are the same kinds used by the inertial frame, which will be related by my transformation equations. That is why I bring up these transformation equations. They give you a way to relate the standards of time and space for an accelerated observer to the standards of time and space for an inertial frame observer that guarantees that the kinds of clocks and rulers that the accelerated observer is using nearby himself are the same kind as that of an inertial frame. Far from the accelerated observer, his coordinates can do anything during acceleration because there is no such thing as an ideal rigid material in relativistic physics anyway. He'll just use what invariant line element he gets to work out the Christoffel symbols and can do physics just fine with this choice of standards. The second thing that I mean, that during times of constant velocity, his coordinates correspond to an inertial frame, is easy to verify. Here gamma and beta are to be expressed as functions of his coordinate of time. During constant velocity, the antiderivatives just yield gamma ct prime and gamma beta ct prime because they're constants. resulting in what I already demonstrated are indeed Lorentz transformations. Even during acceleration, they must be locally Lorentzian. This means that they must yield c as his coordinate speed for light nearby himself. To show this, first differentiate and recall how I defined the inner product for these expressions. As I've defined these things, you can use the product rule yielding dct as I've expressed here. Now, as x prime, y prime, z prime goes to 0, 0, 0, that is local to the observer, where the accelerated observer is, the terms on the right half go to 0. And what you are left with for dct is what we had when we differentiated in the case of constant velocity with arbitrary direction. You may work out that the same thing happens for dr, and as a result, this implies that local to the accelerated observer, you get the same square of the speed formula in the end, which implies that local to the accelerated observer, the speed of light remains c regardless of the direction of velocity of the frames, or acceleration of the frames, or direction of the velocity of the light. That's how my accelerated frame transformation equations correspond to the natural choice of coordinates for an accelerated observer. Quid erat demonstratum.